to the Fruity Knitting Podcast. I'm Andrea.
And I'm Andrew. This is episode 18. And this is a show about the craft of knitting, where in addition to our own excellent work, we feature guests who are knitwear designers, professional knitwear designers, yarn producers. We have the occasional sheep farmer and other interesting people. And today is also going to be a very full show. We've got a lot coming.
Yes. Oh, I've just dropped a stitch.
Whoops.
But I'm going to show you some of my really hardcore techniques on ferrule. Just short segments, but it's quite intensive. But to lighten that up, we've also got some really fun entertainment that we found for you. So
yep.
It's going to be a bit of a roller coaster ride from short, intensive technique to lots of lighthearted fun entertainment.
So. Yeah, you say that's lighthearted. I think it's actually dealing with a very serious issue, our special feature on the show today, but we'll get to that. We do have Knitters of the World today, and our guest today is coming from Holland, a very talented knitter and skilled person, also a test knitter for none other than Stephen West, which is pretty entertaining in itself. So that's something to look forward to. We also have our video collages, which have been submitted by our Cal participants. So after the end of the first garment Cal and the first the Fair Isle garment Cal, we've got all our participants there. So that's really fun. And we've got Extreme Knitting returning to the show.
Yes, that's where Madeline and I will take a little walk around a very cute German village. We'll start off with Under Construction because Bring and Brag isn't featuring again. Bring and Brag is our section where we show off finished objects. But mainly because I'm a garment knitter and so are you now. Yeah. It takes a while to finish a garment, so it doesn't feature every... That section doesn't feature every episode. So Under Construction, I'm going to show you now and talk about The Blossoms by Marie Wallen. And here it is here. I posted a picture of this on Instagram a few days ago and I got such an amazing, overwhelming response. Like, it was the most liked post I've ever done. And the full credit really has to go to Marie Wallen because it is a stunning design with beautiful colours. So I'm just the knitter.
You're the mate.
But I did get a huge amount of encouragement and, basically likes mean encouragement. And thank
you for
that.
And lots of positive comments there too.
Thank you for that. It's quite overwhelming to get so much... encouragement. Yeah. So I just want to first of all say thank you so much for that. I posted it and it was a little bit deceptive because I posted the picture of it. It wasn't a close-up picture. So you see this lovely garment and I'm talking about how I'm going to unpick it. So, so I'm going to tell you a little bit more honestly and perhaps even zoom in a bit closer so that you can understand what I'm talking about and you don't think I'm just carrying on. So what I posted is that the blossoms up here or the roses were quite uneven and puckered for my taste and I was unhappy with it and so I thought I might unpick it. And I want to tell you a little bit about why. First of all, I think I have to say that I've knitted many, many garments, so I don't need another garment. I don't need this jumper. So if I do unpick this section and re-knit it, it's not a drama. I don't need this in the next month or
two. So it's not going to leave you cold.
It's not going to leave me cold. That's good. And it's actually going to be good for the bank balance because I'm always going to be knitting. So if I re-knit something, it delays my next yarn purchase.
I have to say, I had never considered that factor.
I shouldn't have said it.
No, you shouldn't have said that. She often says, is this okay? Do you think I should redo this? Do you think I should undo it? But that's another factor to consider.
Now you're going to say yes. So it delays my next yarn purchase.
Yeah.
Okay. So the problem, I think, with this is it is intarsia, but it is not simple intarsia. If you look up intarsia, it's usually or most commonly knitted in the flat. So what I want to show you is normally in intarsia, just imagine that's just one colour. You would be knitting with this background ball of colour, ball of wool, so this whitey grey colour to here. You would pick up, just say this was all pink, your pink thread. You would twist the threads around, the yarns around each other, not to create a hole. Knit across here in your pink, twist the yarns around together with your other ball of grey, and knit across here. Then on your purl row, you would purl back here, and your pink thread would be just waiting there in the perfect position for you to purl across and then twist the yarns around again and continue with the grey. So that's why it's most commonly knitted, intarsia is most commonly knitted in the flat, and it is the easiest, most even result by doing that. You can knit intarsia in the round, and there's some really special techniques of doing that. You can either knit across, say, in the pink, and I've got to think this through. I don't know that I can say it spontaneously, but you can loop your this yarn around another way, and then you end up knitting back or purling back, and then you're still knitting in the round on a circular needle, but you're kind of cheating and knitting, purling back within that.
There was the one technique where you slip the stitches across.
That's another technique that you can do. Okay, so but there's ones that you can, there's clever techniques which I can't explain right now, where you just loop your two yarns around each other, so that it's always the problem of the change of colour. Those yarns have to be looped around, or it creates a big hole. So you can do that in advance and then knit there or purl back. So there's those kind of techniques that are more tricky. Well, this is knitted in the round, but it's not just one colour. It's not even two or three colours. It's so many colours. So it's very difficult. I can't see that you can employ those techniques in doing that. Okay, so what it means, if we actually turn it around this way and I sort of show you a little bit of that, if I take away these scraps, you can see that I have had to do still some longish floats, because you have little bits of stitches. You might have a couple of red stitches here and a couple of purple stitches here and four pink stitches there and another two of the pink over here. Now, I already had hundreds of threads hanging down. If I didn't want to have if I absolutely didn't want any long floats, I would have probably had to have 100 more threads, which all still need to be darned in. So all of the weaving at the end also create extra bulk around the rows section, which contrasts between this and then and this section. So this starts looking rather thin and this starts looking rather thick. That's okay, but it does tend to mean that the stitches around the outside will pucker more or pull more. Mm. And that's what's happening, especially if there's just a couple of stitches of the background in between. So I wrote on my Instagram post that I was going to give it a steam. I haven't actually steamed it yet. And if it didn't really turn out that much better, I would unrip it and try it again. So what I figured it would still be better for me to do is to knit it in the flat. So I do things sort of in a complicated way. I took the inside thread or yarn of my ball, because I didn't want to undo this in case I decided I wasn't going to unpick it.
So this is the same ball of wool that you're using for that?
Yes. Right, I just used the inside end. And now I've got tangles everywhere. And I knitted one of the roses in the flat. Whoopsie. Here. Which is, okay, so that's the front side of it there. Knitting in the flat just means knitting across and purling back. And it does pucker less on the background colour. And there it is on this side. I don't know that this is actually going to show you more, but I think that is going to be better. So how do I knit it in the flat if it's at the top of a yoke that's knitted in the round? So that's quite easy, actually, because where you've got the decreases in the yoke is one here, sort of like a raglan, and around the back. I need your hands. You're trying to come up with a... Andrew thinks it's an engineering feat.
Yeah, it's all about tension, I'm sure.
Yeah, but also how we actually do it. You think it's an engineer's brain has to get to it. And then there's a decrease here, decrease there, and decrease there. So all I'm going to do is I'm going to rip back to here, and I'm going to knit it in the flat by not keeping it open in the center back seam. And then I'll just knit all the way around, purl back, and I'll only have one seam that at the end I'll mattress stitch up the back. And I'm hoping that's going to give me a better result. It's about 15 to 20 hours work in this. Yeah. Okay, but the thing is, it is such a beautiful jumper. You really, it deserves to have your best effort. That's what I think. And I'm going to wear it for years. So why not have something that I'm totally proud of, that I know I couldn't do better? You know, if I think I can do it better, then I should just rip it out and do it better, because it's such a small amount of time compared to how long I'll wear this jumper. Yeah. I'll also go down a quarter size needle. That's going to help a little bit. And I've tried it on and I can see that this is... I could lose a little bit of bulk up here. So I'm going to do that. And yeah, so that's the story of my blossoms. Somebody or a few people actually said, why don't I just applique or Swiss darn all the colours on over the top? Maybe that's a possible thing. But first of all, I'm not that experienced as a Swiss darner or an embroiderer. And secondly, in my mind, you've still got just as many ends to weave in. And I don't know that it's any less fiddly in the long run. That's my reluctancy to do that. I mean, if you watched Marie Wallen's interview in the previous episode that we did, that's how she does her swatches. She'll do a swatch and then... because she doesn't have a lot of time, if she doesn't like the colours that she's used, she will applique or Swiss darn over the top a change of colour. And then she can see, okay, that colour works best, or no, it doesn't, I'll take it out, I'll put another one in. So that's her quick way of doing it. So maybe you're right, and applique would be the best thing.
I mean, what I think about that is that it would let you get a nice consistent fabric to start with, and then you're putting your other stuff over the top. So... I gotta say, the other thing that kills me about this is that you try to do something on the whole jumper, you know.
I haven't. I did it here.
You did this after you've knitted. I mean, you've finished there, haven't you? You've done. You're at the top of the roses there. So you've done all the hard work at the whole scale of the jumper, and now you're doing a swatch to see if it works better a different way.
I know, but I don't actually want to. Look... It is true. I do want to finish this. I want to get this done and finished it. And that's why I'm a bit of a monogamous knitter. I feel like if I have a project that's almost finished and I put it aside, I may never pick it up again. And I just don't want to get that. You know, I feel like I want to push through and just finish this as well as I can. I know, because if I ever put it down, it's going to be sitting there almost done. And there's a certain momentum when you're on a project, you get going, you get going, get going. But if I was to put it down, the mental effort of picking it up, I think, anyway.
Yep. Hey, so, can I ask you a question?
Very quickly.
Yeah. Why have you got floats here?
Because I was still cheating. If I...
just a slacker. It's just corners at every point.
I'm cutting corners. Look, I was wanted to get a basic idea of if it was going to get better for me, but I was too lazy to introduce a new yarn, so I actually didn't even do the pattern that Marie Wallen knit has done exactly. I just shaded it as if I was drawing. You know, when you're drawing and you put in a bit of this colour and a bit of that colour and this colour. I did it with wool.
it makes me think of a still life, you know, where they do the paintings of the bowl of fruit. And often in those paintings, I don't know if anyone's paid attention, but the fruit is actually off, right? And that's because the bowl of fruit sits there and it takes a week or something to do the painting. And by the time you're putting in the details, all the fruit's gone moldy and bad.
I don't know that's actually why.
It is. Is it? It is, okay. Yes. And maybe that's what's going to happen to your jumper.
No.
You have sort of wilted roses.
We are now going to see you in 3 short minutes.
Yep.
Hey, that's a good-looking sweater.
It's a beautiful color.
Oh, thanks. Sally knitted it for me.
No kidding. How about that?
She sure does nice work.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind having a sweater like that myself.
Well, as long as we're showing off, how do you like the socks Susie knitted for me?
Hey, how about that?
Bye.
Bye. What's going on? Everybody's knitting these days.
Yeah, seems that way, doesn't it?
That's a beautiful sweater Dink was wearing. My favorite color is brown.
And I don't know how to knit.
Oh, come on. I'll bet you could if you tried.
Oh, hi. Well, how do you like it?
What is it?
Well, I resent that. May not be perfect, but I'll have you know Ginger knitted it with her own little fingers. No needles, just her fingers.
You know something? I believe it.
Hello. Oh, hi, dear.
I think you remember Joyce.
Hi. Hey. Only hello, Joyce.
Well, that pie sure looks good.
It sure does. Would you like to have a piece?
Mrs. Nelson, you don't have to know what size sweater Rick wears, do you?
Well, he wears a size 42, but if he told you he has a birthday coming up, he hasn't.
Oh, it's nothing like that. It's, well, a lot of girls at school have been knitting things, and I thought I'd like to try and knit a sweater for Rick.
Oh, well, that sounds very nice. Of course, a man's sweater isn't the easiest thing in the world. You done much knitting?
Well, no, not really, but I think I could learn. At least I hope so.
Well, I'd be very glad to help you. I'm not awfully good at it. As a matter of fact, I think I have a pattern book in here that might help.
Hey, that sounds great.
I think it's in the middle drawer here.
Mrs. Nelson, would it be all right if we kept this a secret just between the two of us?
Oh, yes, certainly.
Then if the sweater doesn't turn out too well, I can give it to my father.
Now, let's see. They've got some nice things in here.
Oh, I like this one, don't you?
Oh, yes, it's very nice.
Oh, would it be too difficult for me?
Oh, I don't think so.
Well, I'd like to get going on it as soon as possible. Could we start tomorrow afternoon? Well, I mean, if it's all right with you.
Yes, certainly.
Good. Well, I'll get the yarn tonight. I think most of the stores are open. What all will I need?
Well, let's see. You can use my needles, and all you need is the yarn. I think about 9 skeins should do it.
Oh, hi, Joyce.
Well, hi, Rick.
Say, I thought I'd go down to the record shop after school and pick up a couple albums. Would you like to go along with me?
Oh, gee, I'd love to, Rick, but I'm going to be busy.
Oh, well, it was just a thought.
How late are you going to be there?
Well, about an hour or so. Why?
I was just wondering. Well, thanks just the same.
Oh, okay.
How's it going?
How does it look?
Oh, you're doing beautifully.
You know, it's not as hard as I thought it was going to be.
No, you're going to have this finished in no time.
Anybody home?
So early. What do I do?
Oh, hide behind the door over there, quick. Oh, hi, Rick.
Oh, hi, Mom.
What a lovely girl Joyce is. As a newbie knitter, she's starting immediately with a jumper for her boyfriend.
Yeah, she could have been in our first garment, Cal.
Yes.
Yeah. Joyce.
She'd known about it.
Joyce, get in on the next Cal.
Yes. Okay, so now I'm going to show you a little bit of technique. So I'm going to show you the technique that I use when I'm fair isling, and this should enable you to feel very comfortable knitting or fair isling on the knit side and the purl side, so that you could also fair isle in the flat. So I'm using my Amaryllis cardigan, which you've seen in previous episodes, and on the end of every episode, it's up at the end, it's opening up, and our patrons, we put our patrons' names and they're going through the cardigan. So you can see the inside of the cardigan as well as the beautiful design on the outside. And it's knitted in pieces, so you have to knit fair isle and purl fair isle. So the next tutorial that you're about to see is only 5 minutes long. So if you feel like you're not up to this yet, that it's too a bit advanced for you for where you are at the moment, I still suggest hang in there and watch it, because you can start to familiarize yourself with it. And that's sort of like the first step to seeing that a new technique's not actually that difficult and that you could try it. So it's just a two-handed fair isle technique and how I catch the floats on each hand. You need to be using a yarn in the right hand and a yarn in the left hand for this method, and this is how I tension it. So I put it over the top of my little finger and around. I do that a couple of times. Then I put it underneath my fourth and third finger and up over the top of my second finger. Then the left hand yarn, which is my green yarn, I do the same thing. So once, twice, and then over the top. This time I just do over the top of the fourth, under the third and over the top of the second. It doesn't matter. This is just what feels comfortable for my fingers. Okay, so that's how I'll be holding my yarn. The easiest thing to do is to weave in the floats on the left hand. I'm going to show you that now. So I go to knit. I put my needle from left to right up through the stitch, just like a knit stitch. And then I also put the point underneath the yarn on my left finger. Okay, so normally it's like that. I put it underneath. Then I knit and I pull the needle back through the same hole and off. And that is going to catch the float. Then I might knit another couple. And if I need to tighten it up, I just pull my finger like this and it tightens up this thread. So I'm going to do another couple of white stitches. And now this time I'm going to catch this float. So I go to knit, but instead of having my needle coming up above over the top of the green, I slide it underneath. Then I knit and I pull back through and off. And you can see that the green yarn is over the top of my working yarn. But the next stitch I do is going to bring the white yarn over the top of the green, and that's how it's caught. So if I do that now, knit another stitch, I turn it over and I show you, it's caught. Now you could do that as often as you like. You could go one, knit stitch normal, the next stitch under. One, normal, then when I say under, I'm talking about the point of the right hand needle. The next stitch goes under. One normal, the next stitch goes under. You can see it really doesn't slow you down. You could just do this without thinking, and automatically you've woven in your green. So you can have it nicely there for you for whenever you need it. That is the most easiest way to weave in a float, the one on the left hand. Now I'm going to show you, if you're knitting away on green stitches and you need to weave in the float that you're carrying from your right hand, that's harder. So first of all, I'm going to do a couple of green stitches. So I go up here and I pick like a continental knitter. I put the tip of my right hand needle around like that and pull it through and off. Do it again through here, around the top, underneath the thread, pull it off. So now you can see I'm going to have a longer float here, so it's time for me to catch it. I put it through like this. Now I go, you can see this, as if I'm going to knit around like this. And then with the green stitch in the same direction, around, underneath, over the top. And then I go back the way I came with my white yarn, back the way like this. And then I pull it through. Only the green yarn is left. I pull it through and you can see that that's been caught. I'm going to do it a couple more times. So I'll do one green stitch, picking it, two green stitches. I'm going to now catch the right hand float. In it goes, underneath from right to left, just as if I was going to knit, but I don't. Then with the green over the top in the same direction. Now this goes back the way it came. Now I've only got the green yarn left and I just pull that through and that's trapped. Couple more. Go to knit, same direction with the green. Back the way I came, pull through. And there it is there, it's caught. Now I'm going to show you how to do four stitches with the right, four stitches with the left. One stitch, I'm going to catch my next stitch, so I'm going to put it underneath 2, I like to weave every stitch here, 3, normal, 4, under. So I've got 4 white stitches. Now I'm going to do 4 green stitches. 1, 2, I have my float no longer than 2. Go to knit with the right, around the same direction with the green, back the way we came, pull through, and I can do another green. Now I'm ready to knit 4 stitches with the right. So 1, this time go underneath the green, 2, over the top of the green, 3, underneath the green, 4, left hand. 1, picking, 2, the third one, I'm going to catch the white float, go as if to knit, same direction with the green, over the top, back the way we came, pull through, and knit one on top of that, that's secured. So here we go, 4 white, 4 green, 4 white, 4 green. I'll show you the back of this again, that's what it looks like.
Hi, I'm Jackie from the Netherlands. I have a big passion for knitting. I'm not from a long line of knitters. I taught myself to knit in my mid-20s, and I knitted garments for my grandmother, my mother, and later on my children. In 2008, I restarted knitting and joined a knitting group in Horen. There I've met other knitters who became my friends. They showed me books from Rowan. In one of the books, there was a design of Kim Hargreaves, a beautiful fitted feminine cardigan with beads. I made it and I was so proud of it. It rekindled my love for knitting and fashion. I love to learn different knitting skills and followed numerous workshops in Amsterdam by some awesome designers. My favorite stitches are slip stitches and wash stitch, and I still knit on straight needles. When I knit a cardigan, I always add a bust dart to accommodate my body shape. Some of my friends refer to it Jackie style. In Amsterdam, I met Stephen West, who is a great designer. He asked me to be his personal test knitter, and I knit several of his designs. Some of them are shown in his latest book. This is one of my latest projects. Chanel from the Brooklyn Tweed Winter Collection 2014. I knitted it in Brooklyn Tweed Loft, color Hayloft. This is such a beautiful autumn color. Chanel is a classic belted cardigan with a shawl collar knitted in half brioche stitch. The cardigan includes a chevron, a moss stitch, and an English rib, also known as half brioche stitch. I love this cardigan because it's such a classic versatile garment and it combined very well with my wardrobe. I changed the shawl collar in a seamless one by knitting the shawl collar in one piece and adding short rows in the neckline. Ursula cardigan, designed by Kate Davis, knitted in Jameson & Smith. Ursula is a classic feminine cardigan, involves color work, stick, satin sleeve on singular needles. I've knitted Ursula during a call in Stephen and Penelope in Amsterdam with my knitting friends. The original design is loose fitted without a waistline. I adjusted the pattern to my own body shape, shortened the body by 5 cm, shaping the waistline by going one size down on my needles and adding short rows for my bust line. This is the Kex blanket designed by Stephen West. He's such a great designer. I love these blankets. They're so awesome. They got horizontal stripes and slip stitches. And I love slip stitches. It was the best knit ever. I made 3 of them. This is 100, designed by Kim Hargraves. She makes such beautiful close-fitted feminine garments. It embraces my body and makes me feel confident about my curves. This is Joy, designed by Kim Hargraves. This is one of my first knitted garments from Kim. It includes 5,300 beads. This one rekindled my love for knitting, and I'm ever so proud of it. Knitting brought me a lot of friends, who I weekly meet in Amsterdam at Craft Night. There we talk about the latest patterns on Ravelry, drink some tea, eat some olives, and have a lot of fun. Knitting is for me about fashion, friends, and fun. It's about knitting and fun, knitting and friends, knitting and fashion. Bye bye!
So thank you, Jackie. That was Dutch Jackie from Amsterdam.
Yep.
And as she told you, she's a test knitter for Stephen West, which would be a lot of fun, I think. Yeah. So if you don't know Stephen West, he's a very extravagant designer, does a lot of brioche, and he's actually got a background in, he was formerly trained as a dancer. And I think Jackie's been hanging around him quite a lot, and his dance moves have rubbed off on her. That was fun. And it was really great to see some shots of Holland, of Amsterdam.
Amsterdam,
it looks so beautiful, doesn't it?
Yep. It's a bit shocking that we've never been there, actually.
Yeah, we should go across. Wouldn't it be cool if we went across sometime and see if we could visit them on knit night?
Yes.
There was a couple of shots in there of Jackie's knit circle. That looked really fun, didn't it? Yeah.
Yep.
Okay, so I've actually been following Jackie for quite a while, maybe 2 or 3 years. I befriended her 2 or 3 years ago. And that's mainly because she loves Kim Hargraves' designs, and I do too. And she just knits a ton of them and knits them really beautifully, and often designs that I'd like to knit myself. This is a Kim Hargraves, by the way. If you don't know Kim Hargraves, she's an English knitwear designer. She did work for Rowan. I think she might have even been the head designer earlier on.
Okay.
I'm not sure about that. But her typical style is very fitted, feminine designs. What's brilliant is so many of them are really great for inexperienced knitters. So they're quite simple to knit. But they've just got added little touches like this that are feminine. You know, like this frill here. And that was our doorbell. We may have to answer it. But before we do, I'm just going to quickly get in. Jackie does a lot of bust darts because she's very typical hourglass figure, I think. And she wears a lot of fitted clothes. So if you're a similar figure to that, she's definitely worth checking out to see how she alters patterns. I think that's really helpful. And she's very experienced. So we better answer the doorbell. So while we're doing that, why don't you check out and see how Joyce's jumper's going?
Well, where are you guys going?
We got days to go to a show.
Well, Tell Joyce I said hello.
Oh, I'm not taking Joyce. I'm going with Mary Carter.
Mary Carter? Ozzie, do you know a Mary Carter?
No.
This is worth all the work I'm putting into it.
Oh, Rick's going to be crazy about it.
Gee, I wish I could have gone to the movie with him tonight, but I want to get some more of this finished.
Oh, don't lose count now.
Oh, darn it. I dropped a stitch.
Oh, here, let me fix it for you. Good morning, fellas. How was the movie last night?
Don't ask Rick. He was watching Mary.
Why not?
I'm sorry I didn't discover her long ago.
Well, what about Joyce? I thought you were kind of interested in her.
Well, I was, but she seems to be avoiding me lately.
Well, maybe she has a good reason.
Sure, she doesn't want to go out with him.
Quite a bit lately, haven't you?
Yeah, she's a real nice girl.
Oh, I'm sure she is. It's just that... Well, there's something I think I ought to tell you.
What's that?
Well, Joyce has been knitting a sweater for you.
Joyce?
Yes, it's a surprise. That's the reason she hasn't been able to go out with you lately. She's been spending all her spare time working on the sweater.
Well, are you sure?
Yes, I've been helping her.
Oh, gee, well, this is embarrassing. What am I going to do?
Well, don't worry about it now. Get a good night's sleep and we'll talk about it in the morning. Good night, dear.
Oh, okay. Then just tell Mary you've decided to go back to Joyce and she can go back to her basketball players.
You probably won't have to tell her.
What do you mean?
Well, when Joyce gives you the sweater, you'll have to wear it. And when Mary sees you wearing the sweater that Joyce knitted for
you... Hey, wait a second. I hope Joyce isn't going to bring it over here tonight.
Well, why not?
Well, I've got a date with Mary.
Oh, well, don't worry. She won't have the sweater finished for a couple of days.
Hey, here's an idea. Why don't I start going out with Joyce? Maybe the sweater will fit me.
Well, Joyce is my girl, and I'm going to start going out with her again.
Well, what for? You've got lots of sweaters.
Well, I hate to interfere, but I don't think you're going to accept the sweater from Joyce and keep going out with Mary.
Yeah, I guess you're right. Well, I'll just have to go over to Mary's and explain the whole situation to her.
Hi, Rick.
Oh, hi.
Well, come on in.
Well, thanks. I can't stay too long.
Why not?
Well, there's something I gotta tell you.
Can I wait a few minutes?
Well, yeah, I guess so. Why?
I've got a surprise for you. Close your eyes.
Oh, what's this?
Go ahead, close your eyes.
Okay, they're closed.
Surprise!
Is it for me?
Of course, I knitted it for you.
Oh, thanks.
Well, try it on.
Yeah, it looks real nice.
Thank you.
Great.
I hope it fits.
Oh, yeah, that's great.
Are you sure you like it?
Oh, yeah.
Don't sound very enthusiastic.
Oh, well, it's just that it's such a surprise. Gee, you shouldn't have gone to all this trouble.
Oh, it wasn't any trouble at all. Just want you to promise me one thing, that you wear it to school on Monday.
Yeah, sure.
Thought you had a date.
I did, but I decided to come home early.
Where'd you get the sweater?
Well, Mary gave it to me.
Well, you mean she knitted it for you?
Yeah.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Yeah, I know that, but boy, it sure complicates things.
It sure does, doesn't it?
What'd you say to her?
Well, I just thanked her and got out of there as fast as I could. Naturally, I couldn't say anything about not seeing her anymore.
Oh, well, no, of course not. Now that she's just given you the sweater.
The worst part of it is I promised to wear it to school on Monday.
That is a problem.
Are you expecting anybody, Harriet?
Oh, hi, Joyce.
Hi, Dave. Is
hey, that's Joyce.
Yeah, I swear.
Hey, Ricky, Joyce is here to see you.
Here, Rick, this is for you.
Oh, for me?
Yeah. Well, go ahead and open it.
Oh, gee, that's great.
I hope it fits. Well, try it on.
You got it finished sooner than I expected.
Well, I stayed up late last night and worked on it.
Gee, thanks a lot, Joyce.
That's okay. I'm glad you like it. I never would have been able to finish it if your mom hadn't helped me.
Oh, I really didn't do anything.
Gee, why didn't you tell me you were knitting me a sweater?
Well, I wanted it to be a surprise. And besides, I was afraid it wouldn't turn out too well.
I thought you kept turning me down because you didn't like me.
Rick, you know better than that. Why, I spend every minute of my spare time knitting the sweater.
Well, gee, thanks again, Joyce.
That's okay. I'm glad you like it. Oh, Rick, you will wear it to school on Monday, won't you?
Sure.
Good night.
Good night.
Welcome back. The postie came and he delivered Nora Gonne's Knitted Cable Source Book, which I'm really excited to get into. That's a nice design.
Yeah, turn it around and show people.
That's great. So this is a recent publication from Nora Gonne, and I've had to wait a couple of weeks for this, so I'm excited to get it in the post. And you're back. So who are you going for? Is Rick going to be wearing Mary's or Joyce's jumper on Monday?
That's a pretty difficult, a tricky situation there.
Absolutely.
I'm glad I don't have to deal with dilemmas like that.
Yes. Lynn Mandeville. I'm going to talk a little bit about Lynn because we interviewed her in episode 16, and she is a Fair Isle expert and she is a very experienced teacher. And she's done a lot of patterns for Fair Isle accessories, which she used as teaching tools for her students. She's Fiddlesticks on Instagram and Ravelry, so you can look her up. And she's done gorgeous designs. If you would like to join in on our Fair Isle accessory cull, which goes to the end of January, you might like to check out her designs because she's got a whole lot of them. They're really great. And you really like the red herring mittens, don't you?
I love
you?
The red herrings.
So I might actually make them for you for Christmas.
Yeah. Just hang on a sec. I'm going to make a recording of that.
We've got it.
Oh.
But she's got some fantastic designs, so she's definitely worth checking out. And we've got a live web event with her on December the 3rd for our Shetland patrons. And so that'll be great. So Shetland patrons, get your questions in. Any question about Fair Isle or any topic in general that you'd like to hear Lynn talk about, put that in the thread so she can be a little bit prepared. We had our first live web event with Jorge Locatelli just a little bit over a week ago. And that went really, really well. That was a lot of fun. It was great to get to talk in person to some of our patrons, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was really fun, a really fun evening.
Yeah.
And Jorge, there were some great, brilliant questions that came out of that. And Jorge answered in a lot of detail, and particularly the theme of upper body fit, because if you're an average framed person, but with a large bust, which unfortunately, that's not me. I'm a bit of a boy, straight up and down.
This is not how I see things.
That's good.
One spunky missus here.
Well, I'm always jealous of these large busted people, but it does make my knitting very easy. But so some of them find it difficult because what do you do? Do you take the chest measurement and then the upper body around the shoulders don't fit or could be sloppy, or, you know, that's a difficult problem for some people when they're knitting a fitted garment. And Jorge went into quite a lot of detail, so that was great. The audio podcast of that is available for our merinos. So, and we want to thank our patrons again. You're amazing, and without your help, we certainly wouldn't be able to and won't be able to keep going putting the content that we put in. So thank you so much for your patronage. Yeah.
Yes.
Wake up.
Yes. Thank you. Absolutely. Absolutely echo those sentiments. We really appreciate it to get that support. That's what's going to make this possible.
So. Yeah. Yeah. So thank you. And if you're considering or would like to consider becoming a patron, we'd be very grateful. And you could check that out, all the information that's involved in that we'll put down here, or you can go to the patreon.com/fruityknitting, and that'll be in all of our show notes, and you can check that out, because so that'll be great.
Yep. And just to mention very quickly, if you have any questions about becoming a patron, firstly, the information is there on the page, but if you have any questions, there's a thread on the Ravelry group.
Yeah.
And we'll get back to you on that.
Yeah. Okay. And I also wanted to say the threads for our two culls, which is the Fair Isle accessory cull and the cabled garment cull, are in our Ravelry group and everything is Fruity Knitting. We're Fruity Knitting on all social media. Okay, so now we're up to the video selfie collage. Andrew's concentrating
hard on writing down his rows. Yep.
So in our previous culls, the participants now who have finished their garments, there was the first garment cull and the Fair Isle garment cull, made a 20-second selfie, and we've put that together in a collage, and here it is. So here, we'll start off with the Fair Isle garment cull. Yay! Yeah.
Catherine, my Ravelry name is Myerwin. This is the Brunsfield Vest by Isolde Teague. It's knit out of Jamieson and Smith 2-ply jumper weight, but the light gray is a singles yarn called Vuorema Vipola. This has really increased my love of stranded knitting, and I'm definitely going to do more. Thanks, Andrea and Andrew.
Hello, I'm Emma from New Zealand, and I'm wearing my very first Fair Isle jumper. I'm totally besotted with it. It turned out beautifully. It's a very simple one. It's a Cleckheaton pattern, and I use Cleckheaton yarn. And yes, so here it is. And thank you, Andrea and Andrew, for giving us the opportunity to join your wonderful Carl.
Hello, I'm Eva, the charm of it on Ravelry and Instagram, and I am wearing my self-designed Fair Isle vest. It's knit out of Alice Starmore Hibberdian 2-ply yarn. And I really love it because it's both comfortable to wear and, thanks to the yarn colors, absolutely beautiful. Thanks, Andrew and Andrea.
Hello, my name is Linda Ulala on Ravelry. I've used county yarn for my thistle sweater, and all the information is on my project page. I'm so happy to have knitted along with all you wonderful people. Thank you so much. And I finished it.
Hello, Andrew and Andrea from Oklahoma. My name's Lynn. This is my finished sweater. And as it's still over 80 degrees in Oklahoma, I still don't even need a short sleeve sweater. Thanks for a great knit along.
Hi, this is Sarah from Pennsylvania, and I have on my Branches and Buds pullover by Carrie Bostic Hogue in the Making magazine. I've knit this in the shepherd's wool from Stonehenge Fiber Mill in Michigan. Have a great day. Bye-bye.
Hi, my name is Scotty Santiago, and I made the Faye Vest from Marie Wallen, and I used Knit Picks palette. I had lots of fun. This was my first big steep, and it was great. Hi, Scotty Santiago again, and I made the 3/4 sleeve pullover, turned it into a cardigan. It's nice and roomy, maybe a little bit big, but it's great. It's out of Fiber Natura, Shepherd's Own, and the pink is some handspun that I did. So this is my first time trying to get some handspun into my color work.
Hi, my name is Scotty Santiago, and this is my winter doldrums that I made out of Knit Picks wool of the Andes worsted weight. I had to wait for a back order, and I'm so happy I got my yarn in time to finish. This has been fun. Thanks for the opportunity.
Hi everyone, it's Tina here from Sydney, Australia. I've almost finished my Colourwork sweater. It's in Rowan Felted Tweed. The designs I've chosen from Alice Starmore's book on Fair Isle Knitting. And I'm completely addicted to Colourwork now. Thank you, Andrew and Andrea, and everybody who's participated. Thanks.
Tilly Trout, my seaside jumper. This is the front, the back. Designed by me. That's it. Bye.
That was great. So many fantastic jumpers, and one person got a prize, and that's brilliant. But really, the prizes are the jumpers that you're now wearing through winter, and they're all gorgeous jumpers.
Yeah, a lot of spectacular work there.
Yeah, and I thought it was so funny if you see Tilly, she's on the beach dancing in her beach jumper. That was really funny.
Oh, what do you call it? The dog burst in. What is it called? Photo bombing. Yeah,
Photo bombing.
Well done.
We first saw Tilly on the Bakery Bears podcast.
Yep.
That's a really great podcast if you don't know about it. And they've got a section on it called Knit or Forfeit, where they do these...
It's a game show.
Yeah, it's a game show, like a knitting quiz show. And that's where we first saw Tilly, and she was on against Kay. Kay is one of the presenters of the Bakery Bears.
Yep.
And it was fun to see her there. And she's a character. And she's designed her own garment, and it was gorgeous. And all of the garments were gorgeous. So well done to all of you. And now here is the first garment, Carl.
Yay.
Selfies.
This is Catherine Kirby from Hanover, Pennsylvania. Yay, I finished my first sweater. This is called In Stillness, and I especially liked the tubular bind-off, which that was also my first time to do this. I would encourage anyone that wants to make a sweater, don't shy away. It's not that hard. I'm very proud of it. It's for my granddaughter, Michaela. Thank you.
Hi, Pretty Knitters. It's Linda, back again with the finished product, the Order of the Garter pattern. I knit it with my own homespun yarn. Turned out great. It's nice. I really enjoyed the cap.
Hello, all of the Fruity Knitting watchers and Andrew and Andrea. My name's Grace, and you can find me as Vanna Willamiel on Instagram. I'm in Sydney at the moment, which means after I finish my beautiful all-year cardigan by Tagia Hilliard out of some Eskills 100% wool, I have to pack it away for the summer. But I loved knitting it, and thank you for this amazing cowl which helped me do it.
Yay, what an amazing achievement for you all.
Yep.
With the three beautiful garments, so well done. I hope that's the first of many more.
They were all very successful, weren't they?
Yeah, yeah.
I'm impressed.
Absolutely.
And I still can't get over the self-spun yarn.
Yeah, which I was just about to say that. That's a super, super good effort.
I think it's super cool. Yeah.
So thanks so much to all of the people who contributed and did their 20-minute selfie and
20 minutes.
20-minute selfie, 20-second selfie. I was so strong at telling you only 20 seconds.
Yeah.
Okay, so thank you so much. And another contributor also did, but we cut off the date early because we had to do it all a little bit too early. So we might just put in very quickly a picture of another completed garment that didn't quite make it in the video. But thank you to everybody. It was wonderful. It was so great to see you, see your contribution. And may you knit many more garments. So I think we should see what Rick is going to do.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, I'll say this much. They're both good-looking sweaters.
Well, I know that.
Well, don't get mad at me.
I'm not getting mad at anybody. Somebody's going to get mad at me, either Mary or Joyce.
Don't wear either one of the sweaters.
Well, that's a great idea. And they'll both get mad at me.
Well, what are you complaining about? Ginger expects me to wear these. You know, she always has called me a pinhead, but up till now I thought she was kidding.
You guys have any classes today?
Yeah, we're just trying to solve Rick's problem.
Well, what's there to solve? I told you. Mary expects me to wear this today, and Joyce expects me to wear this. And obviously, I can't wear them both.
Well, no, not at the same time. But what's your first class?
History?
Is Mary in it?
No, Joyce.
Okay, you wear Joyce's sweater to your first class. What's your second class?
English. And Mary sits right next to me.
Well, as you change classes, you just change sweaters.
You see how easy it is when you got a smart brother?
Hey, smart brother, what do I do about economics?
Well, who's in that?
Well, I sit here, Joyce sits here, and Mary sits here.
I'll let you figure that one out for yourself.
Suppose we discuss chapter 4. Let's start with Mr. Nelson. Mr. Nelson?
He isn't here.
Hi, Sally.
Oh, hi, Mary.
Oh, hi.
Hi, Susie.
Have you seen Rick?
Yeah, I saw him around here a little while ago. Oh, here he comes.
Hi, Mary.
Hi, Rick. I just wanted Susan to see the sweater I knitted for you.
Yeah, it's real nice, isn't it?
Oh, it's beautiful.
Well, I'll see you later. I have a class. Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Hey, here comes Joyce.
You're kidding.
No, right over there.
Hi, fellas.
Oh, hi, Joyce. Hey, Joyce.
Hey, have you seen Rick anyplace?
Yeah, I saw him just a few minutes ago. Oh, there he is.
Hi, Joyce.
Hi. I didn't see an economics class, and I was wondering if anything was wrong.
Oh, I was unprepared.
Oh, gosh, it sure looks beautiful on you.
Oh, thanks. A lot of people have told me that.
Well, I'll see you later. Bye, fellas.
Bye, Joyce. Bye. Bye, Joyce. Boy, I can't go through many more days like this. All I did was change sweaters. I wish I could figure a way out of this.
Well, don't look at me. I got problems of my own. Hey, here she comes.
Oh, Mary?
No, Joyce.
Hi, Dylan.
Oh, hi, Joyce.
Oh, hi, Joyce. Hey, that worked pretty good.
Yeah, great. Take a look at Mary's sweater. I sure wish my mother was home.
Oh, what do you need your mother for? Is this such a big deal, washing out a sweater?
Well, for one thing, you gotta be careful it doesn't shrink.
I think you're supposed to stretch them out when you dry them.
Yeah, and you gotta be careful about the temperature. I know that for sure. I just hope this stuff comes out.
What do you care? You're gonna give it back to her tonight anyway.
That's not the point. I can't give it back to her with a big stain on it.
Don't make the water too hot.
Well, it's gotta be at least warm or the stains won't come out.
Well, who told you that?
Nobody, but it sounds reasonable.
I know you're supposed to use cold water when you wash egg off the dishes.
What's that got to do with it? This is a sweater, and we're trying to wash ketchup off it.
Yeah, hamburger and cream pie and all kinds of things.
Now the main thing is not to let it shrink when it dries. You know, I think Wally's right. You should have something to stretch it with.
Well, why don't you hang something on it?
Hey, how's this? Step aside, Rick. Here's what we'll do.
Hey, that's a good idea.
What do you mean, good idea? It's sheer genius.
So we're back. We've got, that was some innovative blocking being done there.
Yes, a nice easy method, yeah. I reckon.
Take note of that. Maybe we'll do a tutorial video on that technique.
Yes, perhaps.
Yep.
Okay, it's they're pretty cool videos, aren't they?
Yeah.
They're lovely.
But it's tense.
It's tense?
Yeah.
What's going to happen?
Yeah.
I know.
Yeah.
Yes, it is.
Suspense. True suspense.
Okay. So you've had your little light-hearted bit, and it's time now for more technique. I'm now going to show you how to carry the floats and catch them on the pearl side. This is only 5 minutes. I want to encourage you to hang in there. If you feel like this is beyond you at the moment, it soon won't be. So just watch it through and familiarize yourself with how I do it. It's not the only way to do it, but it's just how I do it. And you might find it helpful and you might think you might be able to imagine yourself doing it and then entering our Carl for Fair Isle Accessories, which would be super.
And this is what Marie Wallen was recommending in her interview.
Yeah.
Yeah, she was talking about the versatility that you get if you can do Fair Isle on
in
the pearl
flat.
Side,
yeah.
On the flat, yep.
Yeah.
So there you go.
Yeah. The easiest thing to do is to weave in the floats of the left hand. So I'm going to show you how to do that now. I'm going to purl 2 stitches and then catch the float. So I've purled 2 stitches. Now I'm going to catch this float. So instead of putting the tip of my right hand needle underneath this green yarn, I put it this side. You can see that, so the green yarn is below. I can even hold it in place with my thumb, and then I purl. And you can see it's been caught there. I'm going to do a couple more. So now I do a couple with my needle coming out above the green, and I can hold it with my thumb there as I purl. So 1, 2, and you can see if I leave it, There's the float. It's just hanging down there. Now this time, I'm going to alternate and put the tip of my right-hand needle underneath the yarn. And you can see immediately where the green yarn is. If I knit it, I've caught it. And you can see that. See how it's been caught there. So this is the easiest way. If I keep knitting, you can see how I can do it. I could even do it on every single stitch. So one up, one below. One with the needle, when I say one up, I'm talking about the right hand needle point is up above the green wool. And this time the right hand needle point is below the green wool. And again, up above, and again below. So you could see, if I do it like that, it's absolutely woven in. So you can either do it on every stitch or you could do it every second stitch. I would not suggest doing it longer than that because then you have to make sure that you're not pulling. This way, it just settles in nicely and you can get a bit of speed up. Okay, so that way I've knitted all of these background coloured stitches and carried my green thread right along ready so it's ready to use here if I wanted to. That's how you weave in the threads or the floats from the yarn in the left hand. That's the easiest way. Now I'm going to show you how to do it weaving in the right hand. Now that's harder. I go in here and then I sort of pick it. You can see what I'm doing. I'm twisting, I'm bringing my finger slightly forward, the same time putting the tip around and hooking it through. Okay, I'll do it again. And that's a purl. Now this time, if I want to catch this float, I take the yarn and I go from left underneath the tip to right. Now I'm going to put my green yarn over the top. So I'm doing opposite directions. You see this? I'm going left to right with the white yarn, right to left over the top with the left yarn. Then I'm going to retrace my steps with this yarn and go back the way I came. And then I'm going to pull it through. And you can see that I've made a green stitch but caught this yarn. I'll show you again. One, two more stitches. The green thread is underneath, left to right, over the top, back the way we came, pull through. Two more green stitches. Now this time, remember, I don't start like this. If I've got the green thread over, I'm going to be in trouble. So just make sure that the green thread is under. Then left to right, green thread over, right to left underneath, pull through. So here you can see I've now knitted a whole lot of green stitches and I've carried my white thread ready. So you could have an intricate pattern where you need to carry your thread, your floats, for quite a lot of stitches, and it doesn't matter. You're not going to have big ugly floats. It's all woven in. It's a great technique. So practice that with two clear colors for a while until you feel you've got the movements, and then you can be doing it on the pattern. So our program today has got a lot of short sections in it. I hope you're not getting too dizzy.
Yeah, we're certainly very dizzy here. I was just thinking last episode, it was hay fever was the main
concern.
The major challenge. Yeah.
I was trying desperately not to sneeze all the time. Then I had a great big grandfather nose. So the next section we're offering to you is extreme knitting. And I made this footage quite a while ago, back in August in the school holidays. Madeline and I took the afternoon off and went to a lovely little village, which is close to Frankfurt, called Kronberg.
Yeah.
And Kronberg is a lovely, lovely village. It dates back to 1220.
Yeah. So Kronberg, it's got the castle from 1220. That's sort of the big feature that's remembered, or that's the tourist attraction there. Kronberg is quite close to Frankfurt, and it is actually, and it has been for a long time, the place where the sort of industrialists and the bankers live, and it's still like that. I think the
early 20th century, or even earlier than that, they started realizing that it was an idyllic setting. It's very close to Frankfurt, but the climate was somehow better and more beautiful.
Yeah, it's kind of at the foot of the mountains. There's a set of hills outside of Frankfurt called the Taunus, and it's just at the foot of those hills. So it's quite a beautiful spot. I think the Der Spiegel, which is the big magazine here, reported recently that it's still the most expensive real estate in Germany. So, and essentially all the bank managers live there. People may not know, Frankfurt is sometimes called Mainhattan, okay? Because Frankfurt sits on the river, which is called the Main. And so Mainhattan is playing at Manhattan in New York. Frankfurt is a big banking center, and all the bank managers live out there. We don't live out there. We live here. But it's a really beautiful area. All these little, we're Australian. These are really old towns, little windy streets. So I think that's what you're going to get to see.
So you won't see the beautiful villas that were built there in this footage. It's just the medieval section of the village center that Madeline and I walk around. So enjoy it.
Yep.
In the summer, even though it was raining the whole day. So I'm going to plan my cabled garment for our cabled garment car, and I think it's about time Madeline had another jumper. I've done a couple for me. I did my luggage for her. I've done this Firebirds for you. The Blossoms for me. So it's back onto Madeline. So she was having a look at some cabled designs, and she really loved two designs. We haven't decided quite yet which ones. Would you mind holding this for me? So this is Catherine Parr. This is taken from the...
Tudor Roses.
Tudor Roses by Alice Darmore here. And there's this lovely one, a very simple all-over body cable with a little bit of fair isle on the sleeves and the collar and the hem. So there's that one, which she loves. And this one, which I actually knitted myself when she was about three. It was my first ever fair Alice Darmore garment.
Yep.
And she has since redesigned it into a to her Hebridean yarn, and she loves this one as well. And that's very simple. These are garments that maybe you might be interested in if you want to do the cable garment, Carl. Lovely. It's very medieval looking. A lovely sort of lattice cabled across here, and a beautiful cabled section here with some lace incorporated in it as well. And these two stitch cables up there. So we haven't yet decided, but one of those two jumpers she would like.
That is a really elegant garment.
Oh,
sometime you'll have to, yeah. I've been waiting for you to show your
yes.
first thing. And that was one of the very first really extravagant pieces that you did, by my recollection.
Yes.
It's beautiful.
Yes, absolutely. And then the Fair Isle accessory, Carl, I'm going to knit Erica Hoyce's Songbird mitts. And here's a picture of them. They're totally gorgeous and charming. And I don't have a stash, as I have told you before, but I do have a lot of leftover yarn from previous projects. And I have, quite a lot of yarns from Alice Dummel, because she tends to give you extra yarn when you buy a kit. So I've accumulated quite a lot. And these mitts are knitted at a gauge of 40 stitches and 40 rows, which is really tight, which is not naturally what her Hebridean two-ply does, but I've just started knitting a little bit of a swatch here to see how the Hebridean works. And I really love it. It's tight and it's got a very tight woven feeling, which is perfect for gloves because you don't want air to come through.
Yep.
And it's, yeah, really nice fabric. So that's what I'm going to do. So I think that's it for us today. And thank you so much for spending your time with us again. We really appreciate it. And if you would like to consider being a patron, you can find out the information below. But before we go, we've got part four, haven't we?
We've got the last exciting installment of our four-part special feature today.
Yeah, Andrew found this fantastic footage. It was an early American 50s sitcom.
Yep, so this is all taken from an episode of Ozzie and Harriet, which was an American TV series in the 50s. I'm thinking that some of our viewers will be familiar with this series. It wasn't something that we knew, but it's really funny. I think it's addressing an important issue here.
Yes.
Yeah, the boyfriend jumper.
We survived that. I do talk about the boyfriend jumper in the first episode.
Yeah.
The first jumper I knitted, Andrew, looked like a Cookie Monster jumper, like Cookie Monster's fur, actually, the same colour. And it wasn't successful, was it?
No.
No.
But we survived.
We survived it. It is possible. And so is Joyce and Rick.
Joyce and Rick, yes.
Well, we'll see.
So thank you very much for watching. We'll be back in 2 weeks.
Good. Enjoy and see you.
Bye.
Bye.
Oh, didn't Rick tell you?
Tell me what?
Well, you know the sweater Mary knitted for him?
Yeah, what about it?
Well, he decided to give it back to her, but then he got a big stain on it, and so we washed it last night.
You washed a wool sweater, Dave?
Yeah.
Gee, I hope it didn't shrink.
Oh, I wouldn't worry about that.
Well, how'd it turn out?
Well, let's say it definitely didn't shrink. This is awful. What am I going to tell her? Well, just smile pleasantly and say, gee, Mary, I don't know quite how to say this. I hope you won't be too upset, but I can't go out with you anymore. And here's your sweater. You forgot one thing. Here's your sweater, and I'm sorry I ruined it.
Hi, Rick. Hi, Dave.
Oh, hi, Mary. I suppose you're wondering about this sweater I'm wearing.
It looks very nice.
Oh, thanks.
I don't know quite how to say this, and I hope it won't upset you too much, but I'm afraid I can't go out with you anymore.
What's this?
I know you're angry, and I don't blame you.
Oh, well, no, that's okay.
Well, here's what happened. Do you know Gordon Benson?
Well, you mean Stretch Benson, the basketball player?
We had a little misunderstanding, but now it's all cleared up, so we're going to go steady again.
Oh, well, gee, that's great.
And you're not mad?
No. Of course not. These things happen.
Hi, Mary.
Well, hi, Gordon. We were just talking about you. Do you know Dave and Rick Nelson?
No.
This is Stretch Benson.
Hi, Dave. How do you do, Rick?
Say, Rick, that sure is a nice sweater you're wearing.
Oh, thanks. A friend of mine made it for me.
Which reminds me, when are you going to finish the sweater you started for me?
Well,
Didn't she tell you?
No.
Tell him what?
Oh, I'm sorry. I guess it was supposed to be a surprise. Well, anyway, here it is.
Mary, when did you do this?
Oh, I just finished it the other day.
Well, I was mad at you?
Yeah.
How do you like that for a girl? Here I was mad at her, and she's knitting me a sweater.
Well, that's the way it goes.
How's it look?
Looks nice.
Oh, it looks fine.
Thank you, Mary.
I'm glad you like it.
Well, come on, Mary. We're going to be late for class.
Bye.
Nice to have met you, fellas.
Nice meeting you, too.
Gee, thanks a lot, Dave. That worked out beautifully.
That's okay. Look, from now on, try to get involved with one girl at a time, will you, please?
Hey, you're not kidding. One sweater at a time, too.
Hey, Dave.
Oh, hi.
Is that Carol?
Yeah.
Have you seen Rick?
Yeah, he's right here. Rick? What the heck are you doing?
Well, one of the nights I didn't go out with Mary, I went out with Carol, and she knitted this tie for me.
Hi, Rick.
Oh, hi, Carol.
Do you like the tie?
Oh, yeah, it's beautiful. Thanks a lot.
What I can't figure out is when does he find time to practice his guitar?